of the Semicha Program. Shalom Aleichem. And we got to, where did we got to? Who knows? Kuf Ein Chet. In the Mishnah Berurah. Yeah. We did Seif Gimel. We got to Daled. No, we got to Hey. Right? Got to Hey in the Shulchan Aruch. Okay. Let's read the Seif Hey in the Shulchan Aruch. Kuf Ein Chet. יש אומרים ששבעת המינים טעונים ברכה לאחריהם במקומם. יש אומרים דווקא מיני דגן. So there is an opinion that says that all of the seven species needs after bracha in the place where you ate them. And there is those that say only the grains. Okay? So if you had like a nice cup of wine or grapes, yeah, dates, all the each one of the seven species that are not the grains, it's not a mozi, it's not mezonot. So then if you went out of the place where you ate, so that will be the machloka, that will be the argument, you need to go back to the same place where you ate to say the after bracha or not, right? The Rama says yesh amrim davka pat levad. There is those that they say that only bread needs the after bracha in the place where you ate. What will be the result of this argument? What we were discussing before, something that you need to go back to the place where you ate it. So then it's more of a settled thing when you eat it, so there's less of distracting the mind from the eating, right? Something that you don't need to go back, so then it will be easier to distract your mind with the phone that rings in the middle of the class, right? Very easy. The answer is sure. Need to vote. Okay. Mishnah Berurah Mem Gimel. I'm not sure that we went through all of the Mishnah Berurahs until there. But no one answered me, so we'll start there. What? So we'll start there, and if somebody will prove me wrong, that we need to go to a different Mishnah Berurah, so we'll go back to Neda. Okay? Mishnah Berurah Mem Gimel, Lachem Imkomam, Vim Alach Misham, Tzarich Lachzo Limkomo. If he left after eating, he have to go back to his place, Levarech, to say his after bracha, more legabei pad, like we said about bread. Mishnah Berurah Mem Dalet, Minei Dagan, the grains, all kinds of mezonot, right? What does it mean, mazon? The literal meaning of mazon is like a sustenance, right? So the truth of the matter, the Gemara says that everything is mazon besides salt and water, okay? There's another Gemara that speaks about, like, if somebody said, like, for example, he took a fruit, you should say, and he said, is yotze dechova. Why? Because fruit is also gives sustenance, right? Except of salt and water, that on that, Chazal says this is not sustenance. Doesn't mean that it's not needed. Obviously, everybody agrees that you need like salt and water, but it's not mazon. It doesn't go in the box of mazon. Anyhow, the grains are more of a mazon than the fruits and the other things. Okay, there is mazon and there is mazon. The mazon that we're speaking about here is the mazon of the grains. Okay, so for the strangest side, we say, anyhow, go back and say you after bracha in the place where you ate, כן לעניין שינוי מקום, אין צריך לברך על כל השבעה מינים. For the, like, about changing the place, what we were discussing before, אין צריך לברך על כל שבעה מינים כמו על הפת אם שינה מקומו. So the same thing that we said about bread, about changing a place, the same thing will be also for the seven species, according to that. לפי מה שפסק בסעיף ב' בהגה, דעת הגרא בביאורו, the דעה אמצעית, עיקר, according to the וילנה גאון, the middle opinion is the main opinion. לפי זה, according to that, פירות של שבעת המינים, the fruits of the seven species, דומים לסתם פירות, is the same like the rest of the fruits, ושאח בו שינוי מקום לכולי אלמה. Excuse me. So then, it will be the same הלכה, like the rest of the fruits, for like the change of the place, so it makes the distracting the mind. Okay? Yeah? Good. Mishnah Shulchan Aruch Vav, Sif Vav. מי שנזכר בתוך הסעודה שלו התפלל ועמד והתפלל. Somebody that in the middle of the meal, he remembered, oh, I forgot to pray. And he stands up and do his prayer. אפילו אם אין שיעות לגמור סעודתו ולהתפלל, even if he doesn't have the time to finish his meal and to pray, שחייב להפסיק, and then he's obligated to stop in the middle of the meal and to do his prayer, ואי אפשר לו לאכול עד שיתפלל, in a situation like that, it's impossible for him to continue to eat until he will pray. In kol ze lo av yafsek, but it is not called a break in his meal. Okay? So that's talking about that he's praying in the same place where he's eating. Yeah? He's in the middle of the meal, and he stands up, and he's starting to pray. Yeah? Just don't forget to turn to the right direction. So in a situation like that, the prayer is not a break in the meal. Okay? Now, what about the case that I told you last week about, that he was like eating in one place and then he went to a whole different other place to pray and then he came back? That's not what we're talking about here. We're talking about that he's praying in the place where he's eating. Okay? Oh. Yeah?
Yeah. Like at the end of his mind, you're like, oh wow, can I do this now? Right. You got your store, go for it.
Yeah. I had something that, like a little bit similar to that. That somebody that I invited him to a Shabbat meal, and he came like straight from the bed. He came to join me to the Shabbat meal, and like I saw that, and I told him maybe you want to pray a little bit before you starting to eat. He said like, okay. So he took the siddur and he was praying like while we're like organizing the table. He will, I don't know how he does it, but somehow he made it and he was done very quickly. So, yeah, but here we're talking about that he started to eat already. Yeah, that was the point. The point that he was starting to eat and then he had the break of enigma. Yeah, got it clear. So, the Mishnah Berurah Mem Vav. אי אפשר לו לאכול. רוצה לומר, לכאורה יש לדמות להב לן ונברך. Okay, so some background. We have a clear halacha that if you're in the middle of the meal and for some reason you decide to stop the meal and to say Birkat HaMazon and you say Hav lan v'nevrich according to the Sephardi custom or Ravotai nevarech according to the Ashkenazi custom or Ravoi Semin Ralm Benchen according to the Yiddish custom, whatever it is, the point is that by saying those words of like you are starting the Birkat HaMazon, so that shows that you broke your meal. So then obviously you're distracting your mind from the meal because that's it. You decided you stop eating, right? So the question is that similar? When someone is standing up and praying in the middle of the meal, so it's like he said, I'm stopping eating and I'm praying now, right?
And you hope they have some kavanah.
Right? Right? So we say that that's a starting point of the Mishnah Berurah. That it seems that this is what's happening. The guy broke his meal in the middle, right? The man that said that he doesn't have to eat, he needs to be able to eat. So according to the opinion that says that he needs to say another bracha to go back to eat, right? But the truth of the matter is that it's not similar. Two different things. Why? It becomes to be that the reason why he have to say amotzi again after saying avla nevarich is, like I said, because he's distracting his mind. Vesiluk, that he makes in his head a decision that that's it, is he stopped eating. But here he didn't distract his mind from eating. Okay, so the prayer itself, the Amidah itself per se, is not enough of reason to say that there is distracting the mind from the meal. Okay, that's a chiddush.
Very tough to understand.
Why?
What could be more distracting than talking to the king?
Right, right. That's part of what I said to this guy last week. I said, like, how can you say that like, when you're praying, you're not distracting your mind from eating? So what kind of a prayer is it?
Yeah, exactly.
Like, you're praying and you're thinking about your meal. So, like, you know, like, where's your head? You're supposed to concentrate about other things when you pray. Okay, but you see that it's a clear Mishnah Berurah. But I'm saying it could be that here the case is because it's in front of the table. So when he's in front of the table, so I can hear that, like, even though he's praying, but you know, when you have your table set in front of you with food and you're still hungry, so okay, so it makes sense that you're not distracting your mind from eating even though you're praying. Yeah, like someone that is getting like an important phone call in the middle of the meal, you have to answer, you have to relate, but he wants to continue to eat, right? Similar situation here.
What about speaking Divrei Torah? People talk Divrei Torah to me.
Yeah. Okay, speaking Divrei Torah is for sure not distracting the mind from the meal. Anyhow, I got a little bit cold, Baruch Hashem, for the summer. I don't know why, but actually, I don't know why. Because the change between the hot weather outside and the air condition inside,
oh, yeah, yeah.
So the like extreme changes, like of the temperature, it makes the cold to come. It says, by the way, that when the seasons are changing, it's one of the reasons that people are getting sick, because of the, like, generally, yeah, no, nothing to do with this virus going on. So that's one of the reasons of saying the fasting or the slichot in Bahab, the Mondays and Thursdays after Nisan and after Tishrei, because it's time that people usually are getting sick because the weather is changing. So in their times, so there was no air condition. So after it gets cold, so it's cold, and after it gets hot, so it's hot. But in our days, because of the air condition, so all the time you're moving between the heat and the cold, the heat and the cold, so makes the body a little bit crazy. Anyhow, let's go back to the Mishnah Berurah. So that's what the Mishnah Berurah Mem Vav. I'm reading Mem Zayin. Lo avi efsek. Da'at ha-mechaber sifd alef davka shemitpal beito. Okay, so that was what I was saying. According to the Mechaber, that's when he's praying in his house next to his table. Aval im olech lebet haKnesset, if he's going to the Bet Knesset, so it becomes to be a break. Achen lefi ma she'anu noktinu kedeat haRama, according to what we said in the Rama in Hagaah Bet, Seif Bet, lo avi efsek af she'alchu beBet Knesset, so then it will not be a break even when going to the Bet Knesset. Rak im lo yasichu da'atam min lechol, as long as they didn't distract their mind from their meal. Ketav Magen Avraham, de'af amotzi en tzarich levarach mirama tefsek ha'tefillah. And according to the Magen Avraham, even a motzi, you don't have to say. Aval netilat yadayim tzarich, but you do need to wash again. L'shem lo shem ha'yadav, because maybe you didn't keep your hands pure for the bread.
After pray.
When you're going to pray in the Beit Knesset and coming back, so there's a good chance that somebody is like stretching his head, whatever, maybe even going to the bathroom, whatever it is. So whenever somebody is touching a place that should have netilat yadayim, so then he obviously cannot go back to eating without netilat yadayim. אבל הרבה מאחרונים חולקים עליו, וסביר עליו דאף נטילת ידיים אין הצורך, but there is also later opinions that says that even נטילת ידיים it doesn't need.
According to the opinion that says that you need until spring, does that mean even with a bracha, or does that just do נטילת ידיים without a bracha?
According to the... That's another question. We'll get to that. Oh. We'll get to that. למעשה, it's without a bracha. Oh. Without a bracha. לבית התפילה בוודאי שמר ידיים מן לתפן, okay, so the opinion that says that the person doesn't need netilat yadayim, so that's that we're judging him favorably, that he, because he doesn't distract his mind from eating, so also he doesn't distract his mind from keeping his hand pure, so he didn't touch anything that will make him to the obligation to wash the hands again. Okay, obviously if somebody knows that he touched a place that he needs netilat yadayim, so then he will have netilat yadayim, yeah. אבל בזה דווקא אם יתפלל בביתו, אוקיי? אבל אם הולך לבית הכנסת, הוא יתפלל שם כשחזר, צריך ליטול לדב בלי ברכה. So again, so if he's praying in his house, then he can rely on the opinion that says that he doesn't need another netilat yadayim, says the Mishnah Berurah. But if he did went to the בית כנסת, when he's coming back, he have to wash hands again without ברכה. אוקיי? Okay, so yeah, you know, by the way, every time you hear like the Arabs from one side or the Christians from the other side, like it's there to remind us that we need to do tshuva, by the way. So every time you hear that, you say, okay, Hashem, I know I need to work on myself a little bit more. Bezrat Hashem, we'll all finish our tikkun and then everybody will recognize the truth of the Torah, the truth of Hashem, and we won't need all the avodah zaraniks around. Okay, Siv Zayin in the Shulchan Aruch. Adam sheyashan betoch sudato shnat arai lo av yefsek. Okay, somebody that is sleeping in the middle of his meal, shnat arai, like temporary sleep, it's not a break. Okay, let me tell you a nice story about it. I met a guy years ago that he got the custom. I don't know if it's his idea that he made himself or it's something that he got from someone else, but he was like coming back from like Shabbat prayer, like night, yeah, he would wash his hands, start a meal. He will say Bikat Amazon when he needs to leave to go to Shacharit. All the time he will like sleep a little bit on the table, wake up, continue his meal. He does it like he didn't go to bed in Shabbat. He didn't want to go to bed in Shabbat. Said like the Shabbat table is so holy, can't give up on it. So every time he was waking up, like just washing his hands without bracha, it's not the break of the meal. Continue to eating a little bit, learning this, that. When he have to go to Shacharit, he goes to Shacharit, come back, wash again, another meal, until he have to go to Mincha. That was his custom. No, not to go to bed. Yeah.
How does the unction of it keep ready? Keep Shabbos till Tuesday?
Probably also the same idea. What?
No, I just don't get how he does that. Like,
I don't know. But I learned many years ago. You cannot ask questions about like big tzaddikim. They have all kinds of things that they do that is. I don't know what's going on with this, but whatever. So. You know.
Right, one of the gedolim was like to tell him to stop. Was told to, I guess, was elected to go and tell him to stop, and then he, like, saw what was going on, and he decided not.
Yeah, I heard a little bit of a different story that somebody went there and told him, like, what you're doing is against halacha. So the Mishnah or whatever he said, like, what do you mean? Like, what, I'm following the Shulchan Aruch. He said, like, let's open the Shulchan Aruch. So he opened the Shulchan Aruch, and it was like this rabbi that came to him, like he said, he didn't find anything that was wrong, like he was reading the Shulchan Aruch, and it seems like everything seems okay all of a sudden, and then he went home, and then he remembered that he looked in his Shulchan Aruch, and then he found that there was this point, and like every time he was trying to give him a rebuke, he was not able to say anything because like everything was anyhow. I don't know. It's a different world. It's a world of tzaddikim, there's all kinds of strange things that are going on with tzaddikim that can't explain, but somehow it works by them. Anyhow, we're trying to understand what Hashem wants from us. What Hashem wants from them, that's their business to figure out. We need to understand what Hashem wants from us. So let's read the Shulchan Aruch Seif Zayin. Adam sheyashan betoch seudato shnat arai lo av yefsek. Somebody, if you sleep in your meal, it's not a break. Agah. V'chein im yefsek b'sh'ar divrei reshut, kegon shehu tzarach l'nekava k'yotze b'zeh. If he is stopping for other kinds of needs, for example, going to the bathroom, etc. Okay, so that's another thing that is very practical that we were discussing a little bit last week. Let's see. Shnat Arai, the Mishnah Berurah Memchet says, "Afilu im shaha meshech zman le'erech shah." Even if it is an hour of sleeping, kivan she'ne'nas b'shena, because he just fell asleep, lo mikri efsek. It's not called a break. Okay. Meaning, there's a difference between somebody that falls asleep and somebody that decides that he's going to sleep. Somebody that like fell asleep, so he fell asleep. So that's called honest. He's forced to sleep, can't help it. He have to put his head down and do rest. Yeah. So then, even though it will be a long break of an hour, so still it won't be a break of the meal. Okay. What about someone that decided consciously that he's going to sleep right now? So then it's a little bit more of a stretch according to Mishnah Berurah. Okay. Okay. There's a whole discussion. What exactly is Shnat Arai, by the way? Also for other things. Also for feeling. What is the concept of Shnat Arai? So my understanding from the halachot of tefillin, there's a Gemara that says that the definition of Shnat Arai, that is sleeping rosho ben berkav, his head between his knees. That is the definition of Shnat Arai. So what does it mean rosho ben berkav? So it doesn't mean literally that the two knees will be like in the sides of your head. Yeah, I don't think so. But when you just like, when you're sitting down and you're putting your head down on the table, so that's called rosho ben berkav. Like if like the line of the head is between the legs, between the knees, yeah. And it's not the same if you're lying down. If you're lying down, so then you don't have rosho ben berkav. The head is not between the knees. Yeah. So that's my understanding. That like when you're sitting on a chair and you're putting your head down, that's called shnat arai. Somebody that is like lying down on a bench, for example, even though he didn't go to bed, but that's already like it's not Shnat Arai. To say that won't be a break in the meal, that's much harder. Not to have a break in the meal, so it means, to my humble opinion, when he's putting his head down on the table without lying down. Okay. So
I have a question.
Yes.
So for Seif Zayin, why does Mishnah Berurah determine that the amount of time that is the differentiation between an interruption or not an interruption? Why does he determine that it is 1 hour rather than 72 minutes?
Let's start with the question. When he says erech sha'ah, a value of an hour, so is it specifically an hour, or it can be like different times? Maybe it can be different times. Doesn't have to be exactly an hour. Like maybe even 72 minutes. Okay, it's not 100% like clear definition of is it have to be exactly an hour, around an hour, or it can be. Let's say if it's 2 hours, so then it is a break. It seems like that. Yeah, it seems like that. But so let's say that the Mishnah Berurah is exact, that it's an hour and not 72 minutes. So then it will be clear that erech sha'ah, around an hour. So how can you stretch it? How much can you stretch it? To 72 minutes. If it's 72 minutes, so then it's like over the permitted time, and then it is a break. Okay, but it's not really like a clear point. If what about like more than 72 minutes? Okay, we need to find like a some kind of later commentary, because this guy that I told you about, he was putting his head down to even like 2-3 hours, and he didn't count it as a break. It's not a proof to the Mishnah Berurah, but I'm just saying that I can see that Simon will have longer break than an hour. Okay, it's a point that we need to find like a later commentary. I don't have here. Okay, Bezrat Hashem, it's a good question. Will Bezrat Hashem will find if it is. Have to be an hour, or it can be even more than 72 minutes. But it seems it's the simple understanding of the Mishnah Berurah is that it goes until from like about an hour, meaning not more than the 72 minutes. That's the simple understanding. If he's sleeping on his bed, so obviously it is a break. Then everybody agrees that this is distracting his mind from the meal. Okay, Mishnah Berurah Mem Tet Lenkava Ulnedilat Adayim Tzarich.
Oh, Shepherd. The Mishnah Berurah by Tefillah, that which you're quoting before the Makaber. Mishnah Berurah there says Sheinas Arai that Yesh Omrim Shein LaKava. Even if somebody's Sheinas Arai for a long period of time, so there's a Yesh Omrim that there's no Keva for a Sheinas Arai.
What is the definition of En LaKava?
In terms of Zman, meaning he says Yesharm and Shane Lakeva, but Yesharm in that it's like 18 minutes or something.
Yeah. So there is a concept of Shnat Arai that it's about the time.
Yeah.
What is the time that the person is sleeping? And then they bring the whole thing of David HaMelech that he was sleeping like 60 breath.
So 18 minutes?
So they said that 16... that 60 breaths is about half an hour. That's what I remember. I it's a long time since I saw it inside. So that was what I was holding until I saw this chazal. I think it's in Masechet Sukkah, if I'm not mistaken, about the sachatad from Tfilin, that he says like echidah mishnat arai roshol ben berkav. So that's a different concept. It's not about the time. It's about the position of how the person is sleeping. Anyhow, about going to the bathroom in the middle of the meal, so that's the whole argument. Okay, here we see that according to the Rama and the Mishnah Berurah, it will not be a break in the meal, so the person will just have to do an netilat yadayim. It's a question about the bracha on the netilat yadayim, but he will not have to say a motzi again. Okay, what's the reason? Because some people, maybe most of the people, when they starting to eat, they have in mind that they might or they should probably gonna go to the bathroom in the middle of the meal, and because they have it in their mind when they're saying a motzi, when they're saying another dime, so then it doesn't count to be a break in the meal. Yeah, that's the concept. Somebody that for him it's not his custom to go to the bathroom in the middle of the meal. So then it might be that it will be a break if he needs to go to the bathroom in the middle, because for him it's not his custom. So when he's doing his like first bracha, so he doesn't have that in mind that probably will go, right? Okay. So we finished Kuf Ein Chet Baruch Hashem, and we're starting Siman Kuf Ein Tet. Okay, let's talk.
I see here that we learned that it says here Avol Mitzvah Zedayim, it says without a bracha, right? I would say believe bracha. So would that also apply for, let's say, this is for sleep, right?
Yeah.
So then would that also apply, let's say, if he goes to the washroom, the same.
So the washroom is okay. the bottom line, after all of the like ins and outs of the halacha there of Netilat Yadayim, so the bottom line is that if he goes to, if he's touching a place of Makom HaTinofet, if he's touching like the place of like real dirtiness with his hands, and then he it says like for sure you have to say Netilat Yadayim. Okay, as long as he didn't touch the place of real dirtiness, so then he like sefek brachot lakel, and he doesn't say the bracha. That's the bottom line.
If he wipes himself, is that also considered?
Good question. Not clear. If he's like if he's touching without touching, because he's touching the paper, whatever. So then there's no clear definition of like what does it mean halachically. Does it mean like touching or not like touching? But lemaise, all of the doubts there, it's sefek brachot lakel. So also that will join. You say like sefek brachot lakel. So it seems that if he's just like touching the like paper or wiping or whatever, so then he won't need to say, he won't be able to say Netilat Yadayim because there's sefek brachot lakel. Okay, there's a strong side to say, but he can't say because there's a doubt. Okay, so that's what I said, that it's much better, when I spoke about last week, it's much better not to get to that situation, because then a person have to rely on the lenient opinions, and he can't say the Netilat Yadayim, can't say Amotzi, even though there is many opinions that says that he should. So if it's possible not to get into this place of doubt, it's better. Yeah.
So even touching, let's say, would that also apply if he, let's say, touches a place of the body?
Makom Mechuzeh.
Yeah, Mechuzeh. Let's say not necessarily a place where he goes to the washroom, but just let's say like it's under his armpits or like something that's normally covered.
So again, he will need to do Netilat Yadayim, right? So the opinion that is the stringent opinion that says that he needs to do Netilat Yadayim. Why? Because he have chiyuv to do Netilat Yadayim. So those opinions will say also that he can say the bracha for Netilat Yadayim, right? But there is those that says that he doesn't have to do. So then according to those opinions, so he cannot do the bracha. So now for like in the later generations, so we do the stringency of doing the Netilat Yadayim, but we suffer brachot lakel, so we stringent not to say the bracha. Yeah? But according to the opinions that he needs Netilat Yadayim and he needs bracha, so he's eating without bracha or Netilat Yadayim. So it's not a good position to be in. Yeah, like that's the best that he can do, but it's not what we want to be.
But if he actually touched the place where you go, like you know, then
everybody says he can do anything like that.
Let's say something else, right? Let's say he doesn't necessarily. Let's say he's used to going to the washroom. He has that's a custom for him. I'm saying it's very possible.
I heard an aid that like if you're trying to get out of the issue of washing. Of saying it to a Siddayim, but your hands are clean. So you could let the guy before you wash and then you grab the cup. So yeah. Now his hands, I don't know, maybe you could tell me if this is true. But so he when he washed his hands, let's say they were tahor, but now he was a makshir for the water. And so now touching the water, it makes my hands like also hukshar latuma. And now they're considered dirty if I touch water that he had used.
And then what?
No, and then now my hands went from clean into like similar to the eights of like touching the shoe, but except for this it's more of a hechrach, like
your suffix gone.
Well, meaning like
you want to say that in this case he will say al until at the dime.
I'm saying that, let's say stam after kiddush that first person to wash, so his hands are clean, huh? I mean, he just made Kiddush, said Shem Hashem, so his hands are clean, obviously. Yeah. Kiddush, fine.
Yeah.
So his hands are clean. But so now how is he going
to
wash?
I think that what you want to say is to solve a different problem.
Yeah.
The problem that you are dealing with is when someone, for example, went to the bathroom, came out of the bathroom, washed his hands to say the Sheretza.
Yeah.
Now he wants to wash his hands for a meal.
Yeah.
So then it's a question. Can I say Al Netilat Yadayim? For the second wash that I'm doing the bracha for, I didn't have the obligation to do the Netilat Yadayim because my hands were pure because I just washed them. after the bathroom when I said before I said Hashem Yatza, and I didn't touch anything. So how can I say Netilat Yadayim? So then they give the advice of touching something that will mechayev you to do Netilat Yadayim, like for example the shoes or like under the shirt or something like that, and then you can say Netilat Yadayim.
But then he's causing it. I mean, if you...
that's the advice they give. That's the advice they give. So you want to say instead of touching the shoe or inside of the shirt, to grab the cup when it's wet after somebody else used it, so it will also mechayev the Netilat Yadayim. I see the point there, but lemaise I almost never ever saw anyone that was like specific about touching water on a vessel that someone else used before, that to say that it's mechayev him the Netilat Yadayim. There is very, very small amount of people that I see that they are drying the handles of the cup, of the washing of the hands before they're using it after someone else used it. Basically,
I'm saying if his hands are wet and I haven't washed my hands and some hands, I'm saying if I touch his hands without washing, like, now it's
a not the wash cup, his hands.
No, I'm saying, let's say in that instance, he's washed his hands are taller.
Yeah.
So now, if I would touch his hands, it places in the.
You're right.
So I think
there is an issue like that. I agree with that. There is an issue like that, but I'm saying that like to use that instead of like touching the shoe or inside of the shirt, to have the obligation of saying I'm like the dying, it's a. I don't know.
Maybe it looks more sneeze. I don't know. More normal. I mean, it's also just. The normal way of, like, what I mean the normal way. I mean, he's gonna grab the cup anyway.
Yeah.
His hands are gonna become dummy.
I don't see that there is like a real problem here. But I'm just saying that like I never saw like rabbis that are doing it in this way.
I think other rabbis it's a Milo.
I'm not against it. I'm just saying that it's not. I never saw like a rabbis that are like doing it in this way. Anyhow. קוף עין תת ולהל פה בשם. איזה דברים קרויים מסך הדת בסעודה שצריך לחזור ולברך? Okay? What are the things that are called extracting your mind from the meal that you have to say the ברכה again? א', גמר סעודה טובה נטליה ידיו מים אחרונים. If you finish your meal and you did מים אחרונים, אינו יכול לאכול ולשתות, you cannot eat, you cannot drink, עד שיברך ברכת המזון, until you will say ברכת המזון. ואם אמר, הב לנו ונברך, if you just did the beginning of the Zimun. He didn't start the Birkat Amazon. Havi asach hadat, it is distracting your mind. V'asur lo lishtot, you cannot drink, ela im ken yevarech alav chilan, unless you will say the first bracha on the drink. V'achila adina kishtiyah l'arosh, and eating is similar to drinking, according to the Rosh. Aval harav rabbanu yonah v'aran, according to the רבנו עינה אנדרן, אכילה השני, the eating is different. אף על פי שסילק ידיו מלאכול, even though you took your hands out of eating, אפילו סילקו השולחן, even they removed the table, yeah, in their times, the table was like our plates, yeah? So to take away the table is like for us to take out the plates. אם רצה לחזור לאכילתו, if you want to go back to it, אין צריך לברך פעם אחרת, you don't have to say another ברכה. שכל שלא נטל ידיו, לא נסתלק לגמרי מאכילה. As long as you didn't wash your hands, מים אחרונים, you didn't totally remove yourself from eating. Okay? So. Yeah? משנה ברורה א', לאכול. הוא הדין שיש להיזהר לכתחילה שלא יפסיק. You have to be careful not to have a break בדיבור, in like by speech, אפילו מעט, even a little bit. תכף נטילה ברכה. Immediately after the washing of the מים האחרונים, you have to start ברכת המזון, as soon as possible. מה הייתה? מה יש להיזהר שלא לשהות שהייה מרובה אחר אכילה? That's why you have to be careful not to have a long break between the end of the meal. כל שכן שלא לעסוק באיזה עסק, and for sure not to make any kind of a, like deal with like a side thing. Okay? אחי, צריך להפסיק לדבר נחוץ. If there's something that you have to take care of, Obadiah, if you already did the break, you have to do another, like my machonim, to have the bracha b'kat hamazon right after the my machonim. Bet ad sheyverech b'kat hamazon, until you will say b'kat hamazon. V'lo dami lehav lan menevarech. It's not similar to hav lan menevarech, the beginning of the zimun. The mutar lechol rak sheyverech hamotzi tchila. As long as you say motzi. Okay, again, if you, it's a little bit strange the way he's saying it here, because for us, we're doing the Mayim Achonim, and then we say the Zimun, Avlan Mevarech, right? The way he's saying it here is that you have like a middle position, that Mayim Achonim is worse. Mayim Achonim is like totally hefsek, totally like break. But Avlan Mevarech is something like, you know, it's not as bad as bad. Like it's not as a break as Mayim Achonim. Okay, but how can you say there's Zimun without my machonim? So it's not 100% clear here. But let's say I guess that when he says Havlan Menevarech is not exactly the Zimun as we accustomed to do before the Bikat Amazon, is when we say, okay guys, are you ready to bench? Yeah, like is it like everybody are done? Right? So then in a situation like that, The person that said it, supposedly, like in his mindset, so he finished with it, right? Otherwise, he wouldn't ask the other guy. So if he said it, so he made a break in his meal. So even though they are still eating and he didn't do my machonim, but then he will have to say amotzi if he wants to eat more bread. Yeah. Kibon shelo natal edav asur lehafsik. As long as when he did the Mayim Achonim, then he cannot stop. He have to go on and say Birkat Hamazon. There is those that they say that there's no prohibition of continue to eat, even though he didn't Mayim Achonim. Just he have to say Motzi. And this is the opinion of the later rabbi, to be lenient about it. And then after he finishes to eat again, so then to do my machonim again, and then to say Birkat Hamazon right after the washing of the hands. According to the Bach and the Magen Avraham, you have to be careful about it. And if somebody wants, there's further information in Biur Halacha. All of that is for the matter of eating. To break in speech when he doesn't want to eat or drink, or it's like with the esek, or to deal with something, that is forbidden for like everybody agrees. Okay? So, it seems according to that eating is less severe than dealing with something else, or speaking, which is a little bit strange, but I think that the simple understanding is that except of the thing of Samuch Netila Barcha, that you have to do the Birkat Hamazon right after the Mayim Achonim, also you have a reason of that, like when someone is like starting to speak or to deal with something that is like nothing to do with the meal, so there's a possibility that he will forget to break, to say Birkat Hamazon, yeah? Starting to deal with something, and one thing leads to another, and then someone might forget to say Birkat Hamazon altogether. So, for sure. So, anyhow, that's the more severe side that is more than like more severe than eating. Anyhow, Gimel Avlan Menevarech Perush Ten Lanu Kos Levarech. Okay, what is the literal translation of Havlan? Is give us, right? Give us what? Havlan v'nevarech. Give us and we will say Birkat Hamazon. Give us what? So the Mishnah Berurah, give us a cup of wine. To say the Birkat Hamazon and a cup of wine. Okay? So in their times, like the custom was like you don't say Birkat Hamazon without kosher bracha, without a cup of wine. It's impossible. How can you do that? Say Birkat Hamazon and a cup of wine. That's the proper way to say Birkat Hamazon, right? If somebody is saying like without a cup, if they say let's bench, let's say because Amazon, if can dinah, that will be the same thing. So it is like havlam v'nevarech. Yeah, you don't have to say those specific words. The same thing if somebody thought that that's it, he doesn't need to drink anymore. And then he decides that he does want to have another zip of wine or whatever before Birkat Hamazon. He will have to say the first bracha, she'akol, or bore pre gefen, whatever it is. Yeah?
After the mayim achronim.
After the mayim achronim. Yeah. Or after the saying the words of let's bench.
What's Peshat in like? I never understood it. Like when they say that Havlam Mevarech, after people say Shemayim or something, what's the connection of?
When they say Shemayim, it means Birshut Shemayim, with the permission of heavens. Havlam Mevarech. Let's say Birkat Hamazon.
Yeah.
So the answer Shemayim, they mean to say with the permission of heavens. Whatever we do is with the permission of heavens. And there's a source for that, by the way, from the Zohar. The Zohar is like he's saying that when they do that, so it removes the sitra acha from the table. So it's like the Zohar is praising those that are doing that. So it's a question for the Zimun of the Ashkenazim. If you get like this quality that the Zohar is speaking about, so that's sometimes I have like a possibility of to give the Zimun for Ashkenazi or Sfaradi on my table. So sometimes I decide to give it to Sfaradi because I want to get this quality of the Zohar. Anyhow,
I heard many a meeting like thorns and like things like that before the Suda to be kind of the cloth.
The cloth of the Adam Rishon, yeah. There is
anybody Suda. Does it?
There is people that do that, but not so many people.
What are they doing?
It's like it's not human food. It's like
to eat like simple grass from the field, that is not like human food. Like specifically if it is something that is like thorny.
Like eating thorns and thistles to remove the thorns and thistles.
No, just something that
to remove the spiritual thorns and thistles from around the
growth. No, it's like.
Because we see that the spiritual rose is surrounded by thorns and thistles.
Yeah, it's not talking about the thorns of the roses. It's not talking about those kind of thorns. It's talking about thorns that are like
spirituals, not the
that's another thing. You don't want to eat those, the spiritual thorns. No, don't eat
them. That's my question.
Yeah, so don't eat them.
Different thorns. So then what's this?
To go out to the field and to get some grass that is like usually people are not eating. Usually it's food animal, and to eat it before the meal or after the meal. To have that, like, to say there's the curse that Hashem gave to Adam Rishon is kotz v'dardar tatzmiach lach, that the land will give you like kotz v'dardar, and that will be your food, yeah, instead of the fruits of Gan Eden. So the Rizal custom was to eat it a little bit, like sometimes to have the, yeah.
Anyhow, this commandment.
Yeah. Okay. It's not exactly a commandment. It's a curse.
I mean, better. It's probably better to be mekayem that way than in another way. Saying like, if the bread is going to be cursed, if the one of the, I mean, if the yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So we'll hold it here with the help of Hashem, and Bezrat Hashem to be continued tomorrow. I was thinking to change the schedule this week, but I thought like. Today, everything is like flexible now. But it seems that maybe like we'll stretch it until Shavuot, and in meantime, like until Shavuot, so we'll get to be more solid. And then after Shavuot, maybe we'll have a different schedule. So, whenever I will have news, I will share it with you. I don't know yet, but I'm trying to figure out. One of the things that I'm like debating in my head is like. If to what is better to keep the like the Semicha program that I want to do as 4 years as I was planning originally, and then or not to open it that it will be more than 4 years, like 6 or 7 years, that's one question. to keep it 4 years, so then it will be a question of like what to give up, because it seems that like all what I wanted to do, so it will be more than 4 years. Yeah, even if we're doing 2 hours a day, now we're doing 1 hour a day, so for sure it's like too little. But even if we do, like, supposedly the people that are really doing smicha, it takes them like more than 4 years, even though they are learning like all day. So let's say we're not thinking about like whole day, but half a day, like 3 hours, 3.5 hours. That should, what should be a chatchila. Yeah, I have like a student in Tzfat that is doing like smicha program, is doing like 3.5 hours a day. So that's something that is like significant amount that you can cover ground. So I'm trying to build up like an idea of like what to do. So maybe some subjects we will do like we're doing now, just like Shulchan Aruch Mishneh Berurah. Some subjects we will do even maybe just Kitzur Shulchan Aruch, just to have the concepts. And some other subjects we will go more in depth. So we'll have like few points in Halakha that we did more thoroughly. So anyhow, I'm trying to come up with an idea for the as we're getting on, Bezrat Hashem, it gets more clear. But whatever it is, we need to learn everything. So, but you know, can't do it all at once. So we'll try to do it step by step. Thank you very much.
This smicha program.